mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Do you have a seat? And is there somebody who would like to light the candles today? Or shall I volunteer somebody? Mr. Wayne, hiding behind a pillar is always a fatal thing to do. While William does that, we'll say our responses. And as somebody pointed out to me before the service, we are all children at heart. So, we light these candles to remind us that God is with us. God in Christ has revealed his glory. Come, let us worship. From the rising of the sun to its setting, name is greatly to be praised. Give him praise, you servants of the Lord. And praise his name. And excellent, thank you, coming. And now you get the opportunity to stand again as we're going to say the Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayers. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Do please sit, and we'll have our collect, and then we'll have our first two readings immediately after that. So, let us pray. Eternal Lord, our beginning and our end, bring us with the whole creation to your glory, hidden through past ages and made known in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Old Testament reading from Isaiah chapter 62, verse 1 to 5. For Zion's sake I will keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not be quiet, until her righteousness goes forth as brightness and her salvation as a burning torch. The nations shall see your righteousness, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your sons marry you, and as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
It's a New Testament reading from 1 Corinthians 12, verses 1 to 11. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says, Jesus is accursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except in the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. But to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All of these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second hymn is known as Every Promise, from the breaking of the dawn to the setting of the sun. John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, there were 6 stone water jars there for Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Do have a seat. Let's pray. Father God, we've just heard your word, and amongst which are promises and assurances. And as we've just sung, pray that you will give us the confidence and the assurance and the ability through your Holy Spirit to live according to your will and your ways. And we pray that you will open our hearts, our minds, and our spirits to what your word is teaching us today. Amen. The Corinthian church was a lively church, put it mildly, but it wasn't actually the healthiest of churches, which is why Paul wrote this letter. And at this point, he's addressing their attitudes to being spiritual and spiritual gifts. Many of their backgrounds came from places where they expected all kinds of ecstatic utterances and trances and strange spiritual events, usually accompanied or preceded by physical cutting or drink or drugs or combinations of those kind of things. So Paul is writing and showing them what a healthy Christian community can look like. And here in this passage, we see that it's first of all built on God's love and God's generosity to all his people, and that God is a giver of good gifts. Now these gifts may not be cars or houses or holidays or handbags or watches or whatever. But the gifts that God gives us are exciting, engaging, uplifting, upbuilding, challenging, and actually worth much more than any of those examples that I've cited. I have asked God to gift me an Aston Martin or a Maserati, Quattroporte, of course, because I'm not unreasonable. But as yet, he doesn't seem to be inclined so to do. He says he's got lots of gifts which are for the benefit of the Christian community and the wider community, rather than just for my personal pleasure. When we tend to give gifts, whether it's a birthday or Christmas, we tend to give them for the benefit of the person we're giving the gift to. People tend to look at us a bit askew and askance if we give them a present for ourselves rather than for them. How many wives have really appreciated being given a train set for Christmas? Well, God does things differently. God gives gifts for the benefit of everyone, for the community. Now, the gifts of the Spirit are variously not around or not spoken to, or are associated with what some people sneeringly call the happy clappy brigade. We, of course, don't behave like that. But God, out of his love and his care, actually does give spiritual gifts to his people for our communal benefit, whether we're happy clappy or dead miserable. Now, I want to read you a quote from somebody addressing churches that take a dim view of the Holy Spirit and the spiritual gifts. In our times, because of the almost universal coldness towards the holy faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, we have reached a state in which we may be said to have withdrawn almost entirely from the true Christian life with the Holy Spirit. That was written by Saint Seraphim several centuries ago. I know he wasn't an Anglican, but you know, he was still Christian. So this challenge which we have as a church with the Holy Spirit does seem to be ever thus. And people like St. John Chrysostom and Seraphim, I've just quoted, they sort of lamented the church's coldness to the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. And like Isaiah in our opening passage, they could not keep silent for the benefit of Jerusalem and Zion, that picture of God's people, and for the glory of God. And it remains the same. We should be passionate for the fullness of living healthy spiritual Christian lives, individually and as a community. And as an indication of God wanting to know us, and us, more importantly, to know him, to be in relationship with him, verse 1 of our Corinthians 12 passage shows us that God doesn't want us to be ignorant. He wants us to know about and to be informed about the Holy Spirit and spiritual gifts. They're a package. But he doesn't want us to know about the Holy Spirit. He wants us to know the Holy Spirit. And he wants us to experience the gifts of the Spirit. In verses 2 and 3, we're shown, pointed to the fact that there are fakes around and to be aware that there are counterfeit gifts. And just like we should avoid counterfeit coins, notes, parts and goods, we should avoid counterfeit spirituality, counterfeit spiritual gifts as well. When it comes to what people's spiritual lives look like and any gifts they may be presenting or offering, the question to ask as we move on down is essentially, is Jesus being honoured, praised and glorified? Are people being strengthened in their faith by of him? Are they being drawn to him? Or is he being ignored, belittled and rejected? And in some cases, is he being cursed? If things aren't pointing and drawing to Jesus, we should be wary of them. The Bible tells us that we can only say Jesus is Lord And conversely, we cannot say Jesus be cursed if we know him and the Holy Spirit is living and working in us. Now, this saying isn't merely mouthing the words, because it's true, anybody can say Jesus is Lord, whether or not you've got your fingers crossed behind your back. What Paul is talking about here is saying it in your life as well as with your lips. It's communicating it with sincerity, integrity, and honesty, which can only be done with the helping hand of the Holy Spirit, so that our lives reflect the reality that Jesus is Lord and King in and of our lives. That's not saying that we're made perfect instantly. I think we all know that that's not the case. And Jesus being Lord and King in our lives is a constant struggle. We may start off the day before we get out of bed saying, yes, today I will do what Jesus wants. And by the time we reach the bathroom, we're already negotiating. But God in his love and his faith and his grace perseveres with us and provides us the Holy Spirit within us with his gifts to enable and empower us to do that. Some of the key pointers within this passage that help us spot if and to what degree an individual or a church community is spiritually healthy and is under the good, gracious and guiding control of the Holy Spirit. And these are things like the Holy Spirit revealing his presence in our life through our obedience to Jesus and his teaching, through our lifestyle, through gifts that he gives to strengthen, encourage, educate, heal and grow the Christian community, what the Bible calls the body of Christ. And this is because we are a body, there's lots of different things are needed. And we all need to play our part in that. And God in his grace gives each Christian gifts, sometimes throughout their life, sometimes for periods, so that we can play the part that God wants us to play in his plans and purposes for the health and strength and growth of his community and for his glory. The gifts that we've heard enable each and every one of us who are Christians to give service to the community of Christ for the common good, for the good of the church, for the good of the wider community. And the word that's used for this service, we will often use the word ministry for. It's diakonos. We are called to serve God, serve one another. And verses 4 to 6 show us that God gives these different gifts to enable different services, which are expressed in different deeds and ways. And all of this shows us that God works through all his people, not just the special ones. You don't have to be a capital S saint. It's everyone for the building up of the body of Christ and for his glory. And it reveals God's commitment to each and all of us by giving each of us, his disciples, something for the common good, something to build and strengthen each other. And because of that, no Christian can honestly say they have nothing to offer, nothing to contribute, nothing to give. It may not be what they would like to offer, contribute or give, but it's what God has given us to offer, contribute and give. Because he knows what we need. And what this also means is that when we, as it were, push the Holy Spirit away, push the gifts away, wouldn't it be a strange birthday or Christmas to have loads of presents and we just push them away straight into the recycling bin, people would be concerned for us. And it's the same with the Holy Spirit and his gifts. But because they are for the benefit of others as opposed to us, not receiving them, not experiencing them, utilizing them, putting their gifts into service, is actually unhelpful. It's selfish and is working against the common good and the health and strength of the Christian community and the world around us. The Holy Spirit empowers and enables us to play our part in the body, the community of Christ. God doesn't give us instructions and then leave us to get on with it. For God is with us, as we celebrated at Christmas. He's with us intimately, every step of the way. He wants us to know him intimately, leading, guiding, challenging, encouraging, enabling, and empowering us to grow in our faith, to mature in our faith, to grow as a Christian community, to shine more brightly, reflecting Christ's light and love amongst each other and in our wider community. The Holy Spirit is generous to us and wants us to be generous with one another and those around us too. So let's be unselfish, let's be helpful and generous and active, faithful followers of Jesus. Now, those gifts which we heard read out, and they're itemized in verses 8 to 10, are just a selection. They aren't the only ones, they're a representative selection. Some are spectacular, some are quieter and less ostentatious. Some are up front and some are behind the scenes. A bit like each of us. There's more of us, some of us, who are up front types, and others of us who are very much behind the scenes. Some of us are ostentatious and some of us spectacular, and some of us aren't. Some of these gifts emphasize speaking up and speaking out, and some emphasize doing things, taking action of some kind. Not always obviously, but all of them really important. Some are extensions of our natural talents. God takes them to, as it were, new heights for him. And some are naturally super. But none are to be dismissed or derided. And verses 6, 7 and 11 emphasize that all these gifts come from God himself, out of his love and his grace and his desire that we know him better and we grow in our faith and as a Christian community. But verse 11 also makes the point that these are gifts. God chooses which gifts he offers to which Christian and when. And just like birthdays and Christmases, we can ask for the gifts that we want, Aston Martins and Maseratis included. And indeed, God encourages us to ask him for gifts, and particularly his gifts. But God may well give us something different to what we've asked for, in which case we can be sure that that gift is actually much better for us, our community, and the health of God's body here where we are. And it also tells us, because they are God's gifts given to us as he chooses, that we can't look around at each other and say, well, if you haven't got this particular gift or that particular gift, well, you're not really a Christian at all. And neither can we say, unless you've got this or that gift, you're not as spiritual as I am. The gifts are God's that he gives to us for our mutual benefit. The Holy Spirit gives his gifts to each one just as he determines. So the picture we have of a healthy Christian community is one of faithfulness, of active, spirit-empowered people, gifted by God for the common good of the Christian community and the wider community. And may God bless us this year with growing faith, growing maturity in our faith, with health and strength as his Christian body here in St. Michael's in Ledbury. And may God bless us so that this description fits us. Let us pray. Father God, thank you for your faithfulness, your love and your grace, that you are with us in the Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit dwells in us, enabling and empowering us. And thank you that you don't want us to be ignorant. Thank you that you want us to be strong and healthy. Thank you for giving us gifts. Please show each one of us what our gifts are. Please give us more of your gifts so that we can be stronger and healthier and a greater community for you. And please make us empowered Christian people gifted by you. And we pray that you would help us to put them into service, to take action for the common good of our Christian community and our wider Ledbury community, today and every day. Amen. Please stand and we'll say the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Do please sit and kneel for our first intercession provided this week by Diana Beattie, who I just want to say very graciously responded to a slight confusion that I created for her and rewrote her prayers yesterday afternoon. So thank you for that, Diana, and now to our prayers.
They were rewritten to be a little bit shorter. And so let us pray. From our reading today, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, varieties of service, but the same Lord, varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. So Almighty God, Holy Spirit, keep us listening to you and empower us together. And that will come up several times as we pray. Keep us listening to you and empower us together. So when I say keep listening to you, please join in and empower us together. Holy Spirit, thank you for the variety of gifts you give us to share as church. Help us work as one body to support all Ledbury people and beyond. We pray your blessing on our Rector Keith, all leaders, local and international, in faith, business and politics. May all walk with God, conscious of their responsibility for the well-being of others. Thank you for the gift of faith Queen Elizabeth shares across country and Commonwealth. Bless and guide her successors to serve you faithfully too. Help each of us own the common wealth of your presence, aware we need to even up well-being across continents and within national and local communities, and each to do our bit. Keep us listening to you and empower us together. Holy Spirit, we pray for the gift of wisdom, to hear your word in Ledbury, for all who lead worship through music, reading, prayer and art, our small fellowship groups and courses, especially presently, Living in Love and Faith. Help us each understand what you would have us do with what we learn. Give wisdom to our PCC to develop a vision for church beginning this week with Impact in Church on Building Development, St Catherine's Hall, Local Ministry Development, Worship Development, Communications and Baptism, and outside on all town activities we are individually part of. May we all be one in you in mutual love and support. We pray your wisdom in Leaf, which is locally enable all to flourish, initiatives to cherish troubled people, and for Sarah, our church administrator. Thank you for online worship and the faithful work of Benjamin, Lisa Jane and team, for Charlie's sound repairs, and PCC plans to update equipment. Give wisdom to all who commit fresh to you, especially the three preparing for confirmation in February, and for Rory, recently baptised, and his family. Keep us listening to you and empower us together. Holy Spirit, we thank you for the gift of knowledge gained through your word and in living as part of the mystery of your creation, where you are present for anyone who seeks you. Holy Spirit, thank you for the gift of healing. Thank you for our NHS workers. And we hold up to you all who suffer in body, mind or spirit, those who ask for prayer and those in our hearts. And we specially remember today the people caught up in the volcanic activity and tsunami in the Philippines and spreading around the Pacific Ocean. Please heal us all in your time and in your way. We pray for all who remember people they love and have lost. May all who have died in faith rest in peace and rise in glory. Keep us listening to you and empower us together. As we consider terrible world situations where people suffer, we pray for your gift of miracles, enough food, medical equipment, medics and nurses, for shelter, clothing and safety from attack. May all provision be given and received gladly. We pray for people we know with lives taken over by drink or drugs, and those who trade on such people illegally and ruthlessly to create personal wealth. May those with your gift of miracles help lost people find life in you. Holy Spirit, we pray for those using your gift of prophecy. Give us ears to listen and hearts to respond to their words about our planet. Help us heed the urgency of the climate situation, and each play our own small part to restore the earth by how we choose to live our lives within your love. Keep us listening to you and empower us together. And in the words of the Hereford Diocesan prayer, God, who in Jesus calls us, open hearts and minds to your invitation. God of the pilgrim way, be our companion day by day. God of the still, small voice, teach us to pray. Grant that our calling, our following, our pilgrimage, we may see your kingdom of truth and peace, and delight to bring others to your love. We make this prayer through Jesus the Lord. And we finish by saying together, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We now go to our prayers of penitence. When the Lord comes, he will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Therefore, in the light of Christ, let us confess our sins. And we'll pause for a few moments for us to reflect. The time will be too short for some and too long for others, but let's pause and bring our failures and our weaknesses and our imperfections before our loving, forgiving Lord. God, be gracious to us and bless us, and make your face to shine upon us. Lord, we have sinned. Have mercy on us and heal us. Make your ways be known on the earth, your saving power among the nations. Lord, we have sinned. Have mercy on us and heal us. You, Lord, have made known your salvation and reveal your justice in the sight of the nations. Lord, we have sinned. Have mercy on us and heal us. And may the love of God, the God of love, bring you back to himself, forgive you your sins, and assure you of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Will you please stand for us? Christ came and proclaimed the gospel, peace to those who are far off and peace to those who are near. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And let's share a sign of Christ's peace with one another from where we are, behind our masks, etc. Sing our third hymn, Before the Throne of God Above. continue not to take collections. We continue to offer our gifts and our stewardship to God, both in the plate at the back and the tap and go card reader, the standing order, and the planned giving scheme. So we thank you for that, and we say to the Lord, Lord, accept your people's gifts, not only gold, frankincense, or myrrh, but also hearts and voices raised in praise of Jesus Christ, our light and our salvation. Amen. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all a perfect sacrifice to sin. On the night that he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voices to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break the bread of life. And that life is the light of the world. God, here among us, light in the midst of us, bring us to light and life. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs and clean your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, so that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Before I invite us to Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, I'll just remind you, and for those of you who are visiting or not been around for a while, we have hand sanitizer at the front. We administer communion here by intinction into your flat hands, please, and then if you move to one side and consume in front of the cross, where that's the point to take the masks off. And I will come to those of you who If you don't wish to receive communion, what I'll be able to just put your hands across your chest and I will say a prayer with you for that. So now, let us draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ which he gave for you, and drink his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. prayer after communion together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your life, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And our final hymn is Jesus is Lord, Creation's Voice Proclaims It. Please stand and let's declare it. May Christ, the Son of God, perfect in you the image of his glory, and gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Do have a seat. We have one or two notices. That's not the usual cue. You heard Diana pray about the PCC. We're meeting tomorrow, and each member of the PCC is answering a question in one short sentence. First, where are we going? So that's where each of us thinks we're going. Where do we want to go? So that's where each of us think we want to go. Before we then jointly consider probably the most important question, where are we being called to go by Jesus? So you might pray for us for a good spirit's eyes and ears open to Jesus for that for tomorrow. And while we're on the subject of PCC, from the sublime to the very sad, at least for us, Kath is going to be stepping down as our PCC treasurer at the APCM in April. Kath has done a fantastic job while she's been a treasurer, now time for us to pray and to think about someone who might take hold of the baton that she has carried so well over recent times. So please pray, see whether that's God's putting his finger on you, or if you think God might be volunteering somebody else. And then next Sunday is the 23rd of January, when we'll be having our Christian Unity service here at 10 o'clock, where the churches join together for a joint service. And as you will have read in the email I sent out, whenever it was recently, that our Archdeacon Derek Chedsey is coming to preach, but he's not wearing his Archdeacon's hat, he's wearing his Leaf Trustees hat. So that's the capacity in which he's coming to join us. I think that's all I have to say today. Anything that's... Oh, yes, I have that down, thank you. Choral Evensong, 5:30 this evening. Do come along to that. And next month, we will put this out, but Choral Evensong will not be on the third Sunday. It'll be on the second Sunday, because we've got a special choir coming to do a concert in the afternoon, and they said they will lead us in a Choral Evensong. So that will be on the 13th. So February the 13th is looking like a pretty full day of celebration and enjoyment and praise of God. So please stand. Let us go in peace. We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory.